This is the second theoretical lecture of the week that starts on the 3rd of May, and this lecture is related with special cases. So we are going to look to three cases: the case of the degenerated solution, the case of multiple optimal solutions, and the unlimited solution. Let's start with the case of the degenerated solution. We are going to illustrate this situation using a simple linear programming problem involving two variables and two restrictions of the type less or equal. We are going to solve this problem using the simplex method, but we are going to present also the graphical solution. So, to solve this problem using the simplex method, we need to transform the restrictions in equalities, introducing two slack variables, S1 and S2. We rewrite also the objective function, putting all the terms in the first hand side. So this allows us to build the initial table of the simplex method, which we present here. So as we can see, we have here the coefficients of the objective function, -3 and -4, in the first line, and in second line and third line, we have the coefficients of the restrictions, 1, 1 in x1 and x2 for the first restriction, then we have 1 here in s1, then in the independent term we have 9. And for the second restriction we do the same. So we can extract an initial solution here, because we can identify here these unit vectors that signal the initial basic variables, that is S1 and S2. And we can extract, of course, a solution, that is these variables here initially have these values. So this table is not optimal, because we have here dz, x2, for example, is the sine metric of this coefficient, that is, it's equal to 4, that is, this is greater than 0, that is, z is an increasing function with x2, but we are extracting this solution. The solution that we can read here directly is considering the non-basic variables x1 and x2 equal to 0. So we are considering x2 equal to 0. So this combination tells us that the solution is not optimal, because we can change, if we change x2, it can be only delta x2 greater than 0. And this, because we have this relation, this will imply that delta z will be also greater than 0. So this tells us that z can increase. While z can increase, the solution is not optimal. So we need to change the base. So changing the base means that one variable, one of the non-basic variables, will be introduced in the set of basic variables, and that means that one non-basic variables must leave. So we choose x2 to enter the base, because it has the highest partial derivative. And now, to evaluate the possible values of x2 in the next iteration, we divide these values here, 9 I divide by 1, we get 9, and 18 we divide by 3, and we get 6. So we need to select the lowest possibility for x2, otherwise we will get negative values. So we choose to leave s2. In this way, we identify here this element 3, which is the pivot. So we need to transform this table so that the column of x2 becomes a unit vector, with this configuration. So to do this, we are going to number the lines of each of this table. So the line of z is line 1, the line of the first restriction is L2, and line of the third restrictions is 3. So we use this 0 here to indicate that this is the previous table relatively to the table that we want to obtain, which we are going to show how to obtain in the next slides. So, and here we illustrate the steps involved in the transformation of the initial table. The first thing to do is to transform the pivot in 1. So pivot was 3, so this means that we need to divide the previous line 3 by 3 to get what we present here. So this is the new line 3, and the pivot is now this element here, is 1. Now, we need to transform the coefficients of x2 in the other two lines into 0. So, to do this, we illustrate here the calculations involved in the line of z. So, we have here the previous line of z, and the coefficient is minus 4. This means that we need to multiply line 3 by the symmetric of this element, that is 4. And now, we add these two lines to obtain the new line number 1, which we do here. So we have here the line 3 multiplied by 4, and we add the two lines, that is, we add the coefficients, and we get the new line number 1. So in terms of the new line 2, we have here how we obtain it. So we have here the previous line 2, and the coefficient is 1, and it must be transformed in 0. That means we are going to use this this line, the new line 3, multiplied by the symmetric of this, that is, by minus 1, as we have here. Now, we add the two lines to obtain the new line 2, which we have here. So, putting all together, we have the next table of the first iteration. Now, we have here the table of the first iteration. We can extract a solution, so we identify here the new basic variable. This is the other basic variable, which we list here. So we have here a solution. Okay. And we can say that solution is not optimal because here we have no problem, we have a positive coefficient, but here we have a negative coefficient. Means that the partial derivative is positive. And of course, the solution that we can read here is considering x1 and s2 equal to 0. So we extract these two if we consider the other two equal to 0. Okay? So the solution is not optimal. So we need to find a new solution, as before. So we need to repeat the process. Repeating the process means identifying the variable that go to the base. In this case, the only possibility is x1. So x1 goes to the base, and one of these, s1 or x2, should leave the base. So we need to evaluate the possible values that x1 will have in the next iteration. So, and to do that, we divide this coefficient by this, which is 9. Then we divide this coefficient by this, which is also 9. So now we don't know which one to extract, because apparently we can extract one or the other. Okay, so we are going to check the two possibilities. So we decide to extract first S1. So S1 goes out and X1 goes in. So this means that we have a new pivot element, and the new configuration of the first column must be 0, 1, 0. So the first step is to transform the pivot in 1. That is, we need to divide second line by 3, which we indicate here. Then we need to transform this coefficient and this coefficient in 0. So in the case of the line of z, we are going to use the transformed pivot line, and we are going to multiply it by the sine metric of this, that is one third. This is what we indicate here. So the new pivot line multiplied by the sine metric, and we are going to add the result to the previous line of z. So in this way, we get the new line number one. So in terms of line number three, what we are going to do, we are going to use the transformed pivot line multiplied by the symmetric of this, that is minus two thirds. This is what we indicate here. And then we add this line to the previous line number three, which we indicate here. And we get the new line of three. So let's see what we obtain. So we obtain this table. And we are going to analyze it. So we have here the basic variables, which are characterized by these unit vectors, that is x1 and x2, and these are the non-basic variables. So if we set the non-basic variables equal to 0, what we obtain is the values of z27, x1, 9, but now x2 is 0. That is, we have two restrictions, but we have only one decision variable different from 0. So this is what characterizes the generated solution. It has less variables greater than 0 than the number of restrictions. So to see exactly what's happening, we will have to look to the graphical solution. But now we are going to see what's happened if, in fact, we extract, instead of S1, if we extract X2. So let's look to what we obtain. So if we decide to extract X2 from the base, the solution that we obtain is presented here. So this is the table that we obtain if we choose to extract X2 and not S1. So the solution is, in this case, so we can read it here. What we obtain is this. Now we are going to consider these two equal to 0 and to extract x1 and s1. Well, the z is 27 as before, and x1 is in fact 9 as before, as we can see here. So the solution is z27 and x1 9. So we have a different classification of the non-basic variables, of the variables. So as non-basic here we have s1 and s2. And now we have as non-basic X2 and S2, but we have a different classification, but the solution is the same. What we can conclude is that when we face a situation like this one, in which we have two possibilities to extract one of the variables from the base, we will have a generated solution. And we will have less variables different from 0 than the number of restrictions. So to see what's happening, we need to look to the graphical solution. So to obtain the graphical solution, we need to identify first the solution domain. And we start with the boundary defined by the first restriction. So, which is x1 plus x2 equal to 9. So, to identify this line, we need to find the point in which it crosses the axis. And to do that, if we cancel x1, we get the intersection with the vertical axis. If we cancel x2, we get the intersection with the horizontal axis. So, this is this line that so we identify these two points, okay, in blue. We can do the same with restriction number 2. So the boundary is defined in this way, and the points in which it crosses the axis are identified in the same way. So x2 will be 6, that is this point here, and x1 is also 9, that is this point here. We can also draw the line z equal 27, because this is the line corresponding to the optimal value of z. So in that case, we get this line, and the points in which it crosses is 9 and 6, 75. That is the line in pink that we have here. So solution domain is this one. Okay, so we can clearly see that restriction number one is not necessary to define the solution domain. So this point here, which is the optimal, is defined by the intersection of three lines, the horizontal axis and the two restrictions. But to define a point in the two-dimensional space, which is, we need only two lines. So this is how we get the generated solution. We have information in the problem that we don't need to specify the solution domain. Let's consider now the case of multiple optimal solutions. So to illustrate this situation, we are going also to use a simple linear programming problem with two decision variables and two restrictions of the type less or equal. We are going to solve this problem using the simplex method, but we are going also to present the graphical solution. So, as before, we need to transform the restrictions by introducing the slack variables. And also we rewrite the expression for z, transferring everything to the first-hand side. So in this way, we can build the initial simplex table, which we present here. So let's analyze this this table first. So we have the coefficients of z written in this way. Okay, so minus 1 and minus 2 for x1 and x2. And then we have the coefficients of the first restriction, that is 1, 1, and 1. So 1 in x1, 1 in x2, and 1 in s1. And then we have the independent term 6, and similarly we obtain for the second restrictions these coefficients here in the last line. Now, we can extract an initial solution, of course. That is, if we identify here the basic variables, okay, we can identify them here. Then, setting these two equal to 0, we extract this solution here. So, z equal to 0, s1, 6, and s2, 10. Now, we can also say that this solution is not optimal because we have this negative coefficient here, that is, this positive partial derivative. And, of course, we have also this one here, okay, in x1. But this partial derivative is higher. So this means that the solution is not optimal, and so we need to change it. And to change it, we are going to introduce x1 in the base, and we need to identify which variable goes out from the base. So x2 goes to the base, and we need to to evaluate the values that x2 will have in the next iteration. So we divide 6 by 1, which is 6. Then we divide 10 by 2, which is 5. So we need to select this value. This means that s2 must leave the base. So the new column of x2 must be transformed in 0, 0, 1. So this means that we have here the pivot element, and our first task is to transform this this value in 1. That is, we need to divide the third line by 2. And then we need to transform the other two lines so that they have 0 in x2. So, and this is the table that we obtain after implementing the transformations that we saw before. So we have here the new basic variable, x2. This is the other basic variable. And this table is optimal because we don't have negative coefficients in the other two variables. So we can read a solution. If we set x1 and s2 equal to 0, we get these values here. That is, z equal to 10, s1 is 1, and x2 is 5. Okay. Now, we can see here that this solution is optimal, but in fact, this coefficient 0 in a non-basic variable means the following. That is, we can, so the partial derivative dz, dx1 is 0. Well, we are considering x1 equal to 0. This means that if we change this condition, delta z, delta x1, if we change this condition, delta x1 will be greater than 0, this will not change. Okay? So, this means that when we have a coefficient 0 in a non-basic variable, the solution is optimal, but it's not the only solution. There are other optimal solutions. And to see that, we just need to find a new solution. That is, we are going to decide. So if we change it, changing x1 means introducing into the base. So if we decide to introduce x1 in the base, we need to, of course, see which of these goes out. So dividing 1 by 1 half gives us 2, dividing 5 by 1 half gives us 10, so this one must leave the base. So we need to transform the colon of x1 in 0, 1, 0. So, and when we do this, what we can get is this. That is, we have this table in which we have x1 in the base, x2 remains in the base. Now, these are the non-basic variables. So this we set them equal to 0 and we extract these values. That is z 10, x1 2 and x2 4. So we have a different solution, but the z is the same. So this is also an optimal solution. Again, we also have here a coefficient 0 in a non-basic variable. So, but it's also the optimal solution. If we do the same now, we get that that solution. Okay, so to interpret what's happening, we need again to look to the graphical solution. So we have here the graphical solution. We identified the solution domain using the boundaries defined by the restrictions. For example, the boundary of restriction number 1 is represented in blue, the boundary of restriction number 2 in red, and we also have here the optimal line of z, the line z equal to 10. So we have here the solutions that we obtain using the simplex method, and we can see why we have these two solutions. We have these two solutions because the lines of z have the same inclination as the line of the boundary of restriction number 2. So in this case, since we have a linear problem, we can easily conclude that any point between these two points is also an optimal solution because it has the same value of z. But the difference is that, for example, the first point we get as non-basic variables x1 and s2. Well, the solution is x2 equal to 5 and s1 equal to 1. Here in the second point, we have, of course, have s1 and s2 equal to 0. And of course, we can read it. We have x1 equal to 2 and x2 equal to 4. That is, these points, they are basic solutions. They have two variables equal to 0 and two variables greater than 0. But any point here in the middle is not a basic solution. It's optimal because it's in line z equal 10. That is, it's also it also has the maximum value of z, but it's not a basic solution because, for example, in this point, we can see that we have x1 greater than 0, we have x2 greater than 0, we are far from line 1, that is, s1 must be greater than 0, that is, we have three variables greater than 0 and one only equal to 0, that is, this is not, this point is not a basic solution. So we can have optimal solutions that are non-basic, in the case in that case, we have a multiple optimal solution, and these kind of solutions are identified in this simplex table when we have a coefficient in the line of z relatively to a non-basic variable that is zero. And to conclude, we are going to analyze the unlimited solution. To illustrate this case, we are going to use also a simple linear programming problem with the two decision variables and the two restrictions of the less or equal type. We are going to solve this problem using the simplex method, but we are going to analyze also the graphical solution. So to apply the simplex method, we need to rewrite the problem. That is, we need to introduce the slack variables in the restrictions, and we need to rewrite the line of z. So we introduce the coefficients in the table, which we already have here, and then we analyze this table. Of course, that this table provides us an initial solution that we have here, z equal to 0, s1 2, and s2 equal to 6. So we have the basic initial basic variables s1 and s2, and these are non-basics, x1 and x2. So the solution is not optimal because we have here negative coefficients, so we need to change the base. So this means that we are going to select x2 to enter the base because it presents the highest partial derivative, but this means that one of these should go out. To see which go out, we divide this number by this, which gives us 2, and this number here by this one, which gives us a negative value, so we cannot consider it because x2 can assume only positive values. So this means that the only possibility is this one. So we identify here the pivot element, and then we need to transform the line of x2 in 0, 1, 0. So this is what we are going to present next. And this is the table that we obtain after the initial table. We get here the new basic variable. S2 remains basic, so we have a solution here. If we set x1 and s1 equal to 0, we get z equal to 4, x2 equal to 2, and s2 equal to 10. So this is a possible solution, but it's not optimal because we have this negative coefficient here. So, since it is not optimal, we are going to change it. That is, we need to change the base. We need to introduce x1 and we need to extract one of these. To see which we are going to extract, we are going to divide 2 by minus 2, which is minus 1. That is, we cannot extract x2, otherwise x1 will have a negative value. And then we divide 10 by minus 3. Well, it was a negative number. That means we know that the solution is not optimal, but we are unable to find a new one. So in these cases, we are in presence of an unlimited solution, as we can see by analyzing the graphical solution. So, and we have here the graphical solution. We represent here the solution domain by these two lines, the line in blue corresponding to restriction number one, and the line in red corresponding to restriction number two. We also draw here two lines of z, the line z equal to 4, represented here in pink, which in fact corresponds to the first point that we obtained with the simplex method. And we have another line, the line z equal to 6, just to illustrate the direction of grow of the lines of z. So the lines of z, they grow in this direction, and this direction has no limitation in the solution domain. So that's why we are unable to find another solution with the simplex method, because simplex method only finds a basic solution. So it finds this one. Any point here is also a solution of that problem, but it's not a basic one, because here we have four variables different from zero. So we have x1 different from zero, we have x2 different from zero, and we are far from these restrictions. So we have also s1 greater than zero and s2 greater than zero. So this clearly is not a basic solution. And this is it. This is the end of this problem, and also the end of this lecture. Thank you for your attention, and see you in the next one.